When will this hatred find an end? Taken from our homes to foreign soil. Taken from everything and everyone we ever knew. Shaken at the core of our very being, erasing our culture, our humanity. And where do we begin to remember? Where do we begin to understand? How can we start the healing? When will this hatred find an end? Taken from our mothers, where do we find home? Taken from our fathers, who will save us today? Struggling to find our sense of who we are, trapped in this cycle of never-ending disdain. And where do we begin to remember? Where do we begin to understand? How can we start the healing? When will this hatred find an end? Muted and maimed, disgraced and ashamed, who are we now? Misused and abused, misled and confused, which way do I go? Running away, seems we're running in circles. No way of knowing when this torture would end. So where do we begin to remember? And where do we begin to understand? How can we start the healing? When will this hatred find an end? I'll rise, we'll heal, let's forgive. Then we are not defeated. I'll rise, we'll heal, let's forgive. Don't be afraid to remember. We've all got to start to understand. We've all got to start the healing. Then all this hatred can end.
Poem. Please excuse any nervousness or stiffness. This is my very first formal artist talk. Very long while. So, extremely nervous. I don't have my mother's bravery just
yet. Not yet.
Okay. heavenly voice once asked me, what gets you up in the morning?
7 feet.
When you rise out of bed, sweet child.
Barren, strange fruit.
What keeps your back straight, your chin up?
Blood on the leaves. And blood at the roots.
Black child, don't you know that?
Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze.
Is the cloth from which you are cut?
Strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees.
In the year of the rat, while the world was on fire, the Lord set my vision ablaze. In this vision, I saw
strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees.
He showed me
pastoral scenes of the gallant south.
I walked up to the roots of my family tree.
Them big bulging eyes
pierced into my soul,
and the twisted mouth.
I climbed up halfway, clipping an ancestor from an unknown branch.
Blood on the leaves,
catching her before she hit the bottom.
And blood at the roots.
A lump in my throat began to form. I removed the noose from around her neck. I choked on my tears as she began to remove the one from around mine.
Scent of magnolia, clean and fresh, from the poplar trees.
No more, she whispered, wiping away my tears.
Then the sudden smell of burning flesh.
No more, I cried.
From the poplar trees.
It is now your time to rest. From fire, my vision turned technicolored. I am who my ancestors dreamed of. Because one day I will join them. I want to move in such a way that allows all of my brothers and sisters' bellies to be full. No matter the weather, that's what gets me up in the morning. Thank you. So I wanted to, for those I guess that are unfamiliar with my work, I wanted to just start with an intro or give like a bit of a background. So I come from, I'm born and raised in Halifax, but I have roots in North Preston and Beachville. I spent the majority of time with my mother's side of the family, which would be in North Preston. And that's kind of where I became an artist. My uncle was a painter, an artist. He started at a younger age and inspired my mother. And I was obviously in the house with my mom. And she worked in recreation, so she constantly had me exposed to craft, any form of just creativity. She would put me in some NASCAD classes. And even before them, Sue Beaver, who's from Lunenburg, she's a woman who would come to black communities and teach some of the kids, and my mother and some of my families were one of the people, so I've been blessed to have her even a part of my life now. It's interesting being in the position that I am now, and having my work in galleries or showing them in shows, I never really knew that that was something that myself as an African Nova Scotian could even do. I didn't see that for myself. It wasn't until I went to NASCAD that I began to believe that it was even possible. I was exposed to really great teachers there. I will always mention Barbara Louder and Sarah Hartland Rowe, and there are more that taught me how to paint black skin or served as a comfort, I guess, in spaces where I didn't necessarily feel completely welcome. And so I was incredibly inspired by artists like Nchideka Kanyile Crosby, Kadir Nelson, Kehinde Wiley, and they kind of were the artists that I used as inspiration. They were the reason why I even believed that it was possible for me to become an artist. I didn't think that this would be possible for me. I do have something here written because I'm like all over the place sometimes. So it's specific to this show. So please excuse me from me looking down. Basically my work is based on the African Nova Scotian experience. I largely paint my family members. All of my work are my family or community members. I currently paint on a quilted surface as a way to speak to my history and my background. I'm mostly inspired by quilts from the 50s and 60s within the black communities here in Nova Scotia. These were times that my grandmother didn't know exactly what she was doing. She just started sewing pieces together. Watching her stitching, patching up holes, speaks to her resilience and her resourcefulness, and I try to keep that a part of my process as much as possible by, you know, finding fabrics from wherever I can, whether it's stuff that I already have around in my house or Value Village, Facebook Marketplace, or anybody who has any fabrics, I'll ultimately take them. I didn't learn much about my own history until my early 20s and used every opportunity while attending NASCAD University to speak to my own experience. While sitting in 19th century art history class, I realized that most European paintings began in portraiture. They mostly painted royals or like nobles or their family. The second thing that I noticed was that anytime that there was a black female figure present or a woman of color, they were either exotified or they would be holding a bouquet of flowers, which represented, you know, genitalia. They would be placed next to a white woman who basically was a prostitute. So they were placed to represent prostitution. This is when I realized how important it actually was that the narrative of how black figures are portrayed should be placed into black hands. It's an artist's duty, as far as I'm concerned, to reflect the times. No matter how insecure or how much imposter syndrome I face, this quote that was from Nina Simone echoes constantly in my ears. I was born surrounded by creatives, playwrights, poets, painters, many of which are like family, some actually are. And from a young age, whenever I was asked what I wanted to be when I grew up, I always said that I wanted to be an artist. Sorry.
You're doing it.
Thank you. To not use my gifts, I feel would be a slap in the face to my ancestors and those around me. in the African Nova Scotian communities whose shoulders I stand on. I can't be here without my mom or artists like David Woods or Shantae Grant. This show, Every Chain, was inspired by a combination of a few things. The first was that in 2020, I went through a massive transformation and shift. It was aggressive, but it brought a lot of, you know, childhood trauma to the surface. There were blockages and walls that prevented me from moving forward. In order to flow in my practice, it was crucial that I begin that healing. The second was that something I heard in passing, which was that unhealed trauma in a mother can be passed down to her firstborn. And then that will continue unless that firstborn heals it. This is similar to ancestral trauma, where it's believed that starvation, fear, pain can be passed down genetically. The third was about Christianity. I was born into Christianity, and like most people my age, I fell away. My grandmother would call me a backslider. she did actually on many occasions. while I was beginning that healing process in 2020, I began to study the Bible. Something I never did when I was younger, I would just go to church like everyone else. It was basically like, it felt like a chore. Instead of actually studying it.
The truth is out.
I don't remember exactly what I was looking for, but what I found seemed to be the final piece to this puzzle. A verse mentioned that God would be visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the sons of the third to the fourth to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me. That's in Deuteronomy chapter 5. Out of context isn't the best way to discuss a verse in the Bible, but I think it brought the idea of generational curses to mind. But most importantly, intergenerational trauma. I could never complain or be angry with my grandparents' generation. My grandfather, who I've painted here with, that's my uncle on the side, which is the firstborn male in the family, yeah. I come from a very large family. He and my grandmother were too busy worrying about how they were going to feed 15 children, and to keep them warm, they had to deal with unimaginable circumstances, and they had to keep moving regardless. There was no time to sit and process and heal or to discuss emotions with their children, unfortunately. I can't be angry with their parents that I now have to deal with trauma so that I don't pass it on to my potential firstborn. There will always be something for a child to heal from, but an entire generation of African Nova Scotians shouldn't have to deal with their own familial trauma on top of burdens that they never ever had. Should have had to carry in the first place. My memories of my grandparents will be that of people who did the best with what they had. No therapeutic tools were given to them to heal their own trauma. Some members of the community or of that generation self-medicated and chose alcohol, while many, like my grandmother, chose her faith. Which ultimately ended up saving, in my opinion, her entire family and also my generation as well. The title Every Chain comes from a gospel song, Break Every Chain, by Tasha Cobbs. It represents breaking spiritual and mental bondage, but I've also chose the title to represent the bondage that began the intergenerational trauma from my ancestors. Just as it took generations to break my ancestors down, it will take generations for us to rebuild what was lost. With my work, I hope to be a brick or a shoulder for the future generations of Black communities here to stand on. Thank you.
Your grandparents, were they your mother's parents?
Yes, okay. Yeah, the ones that I speak to the most, yeah. So I have, my mother's gonna sing one more piece, and then the floor is open for any questions.
I'm just gonna do a series of spirituals, so if anybody, if you know it, they're spirituals, sing along. That's the whole point of spirituals, is to bring people in. We've come a long way, Lord, a mighty long way. We've come a long way, Lord, a mighty long way. The Lord has brought us through the heat of the day, and I know the Lord.
Thank you so much. All right, yeah, any questions that anybody has?